Turn it up. You're listening to Live and Loud with the Lord, Nelson.
Ladies and gentlemen, once again, you know who it is. It's the big guy with the big show. Ah, the Lord. Nelson, that is. Yes, indeed. From Live and Loud with the Lord on the CMS Network with Five Royals Entertainment. And ladies and gentlemen, you see this handsome young man right here. Yes, indeed. I got to do what I do. You know, I got to read a little something about him before we get into what we're going to get into, just so I can big him up and show him the respect before we get started. So if you don't mind, I'll do it a little something like this. Ladies and gentlemen, my next guest brings forth an amazing heavy rock sound paired with passionate and powerful vocals that complements their incredible musicianship so beautifully. From being inspired to overcome life's challenges and obstacles to inspiring others to do the same, we can't help but feel blessed to have this awesome band pleasure our eyes and ears. Yes, indeed. So without further ado, I am honored and excited to have the tremendously talented Brandon Mendenhall, architect with the band The Mendenhall Experiment. Yes, indeed. Thank you, bro.
Wow, man. We're going to take you on the road with us and have you just do that opening every night. We'll be all good.
Yes, indeed, man. Yes, indeed. So my first question always is, where are you from, young man?
Well, I grew up south of Chicago, Illinois, but after graduating high school, I basically moved to L.A. I went to production school and then straight to L.A.
Straight to L.A. So, you know, so I saw, you know, doing my research, of course, I saw Kankakee.
Yeah, South Chicago. So.
You know what that takes me to, right?
What is that?
Riding on the city of New Orleans.
Central,
Monday morning rail. 15 cars and 15 restless riders. 3 conductors and 25 sacks of mail. And the part is, all along the southbound Odyssey, the train pulls out of
Kankakee. Yes!
My brother, yes, indeed. I love that song. I actually have that. If that's Arthur Guthrie, I can't remember this. I'm saying it wrong. But I have that in my playlist. And I listened to that because me growing up, I'm older, of course. I listened to that song, man. That played on the radio, no doubt.
What's it called? The Spirit of New Orleans?
Yeah, the City of New Orleans. Uh-huh.
St. Louis? Yeah. It's a great song, man. And it's like, it's the only song that I know of that talks about Kankakee.
Right.
It's a one claim to fame. That's it. And David Letterman donated 2 gazebos in the early 2000s because he voted us the worst place in the entire United States to live and raise a family.
David Letterman's a wild boy. He's loving the show. That's funny, though. That is funny.
Yeah.
So, go ahead. I'm sorry.
So he donated these 2, like, $70,000 gazebos, and they put one on one side of town and one on the other side of town. Whatever.
And that's awesomeness, though. That's a little good tidbit to know, though. I like that. So you say you grew up in L.A., though. Born in Kankakee, born in South Chicago, but grew up in L.A. So what's great about L.A. that you love?
You know, I cut my teeth in L.A. That's where I learned. That's where my first performance on stage ever was. That's where I learned, like, musicianship and how to be good. Mm-hmm. The music industry, all the ins and outs of the business. Like, I came up in L.A. Like, my early 20s was all Hollywood, Los Angeles,
right.
The Sunset Strip, all that. Like, and it's just, L.A. is just rich with culture. That's what I love about it. You can meet people from all walks of life, all forms of business, not just entertainment, but everything.
Right.
And it's just like a giant melting pot. I love it.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. So, well, let me ask you this. So what were you into beyond music as a child?
Well, as a kid, I wanted to do, like all little kids, you ask them, oh, what do you want to do? What do you want to be when you grow up in life? And it's like, first I wanted to be a firefighter.
Right.
Then I wanted to play in the NHL. Then I wanted to be like a Karate Kid kind of martial arts star. And then, you know, all these different things that were heavily physically attributed.
Right.
And that's where the story comes in, where my family kind of pushed me away from all that.
Mm-hmm.
And music kind of the same way, when guitar and being a musician came in, but like, you're not going to be able to do that. You don't have the body for it.
Right.
But I've been told no so many consecutive times that when we came to music, I just sunk my feet in, sunk my heels in, and said, no, I'm going to do this. This is the one thing I don't want to let go of.
Right. Yeah, when I read that, you said that, you know, your grandfather said you can't do this. You know, that touched me also, because I was just like, you know, I've always told my children there's nothing that they can't do. I've always wanted to be, I'm a very positive person. I'm not saying I can't be negative, but I'm a very, very positive person. And I was just like, so when I read that, I was just like, not that I was mad with your grandfather, but it was just like, that's just not me. You know, I'm just like, don't say that you can't do that. You got to allow them to do their best. And, you know, in the Star Wars thing, you're either going to try, not try, it's either do or do not. You know, so
do not. There is no try.
That's right. There is no try. So that's, you know, I really believe in that, man. I really do. So what genre of music was prevalent in your household in your early years?
Country, man. I grew up on artists like Johnny Cash,
yeah,
Dolly Parton, Loretta Lynn,
yeah,
Patsy Cline, right. All the kind of old standard country, western stuff, Buck Owens, all that stuff. They had my grandparents raised me, so they have like a very small vinyl collection.
Yes.
And one of my first memories is I remember digging through that vinyl collection and just putting the different records on.
Yes.
And like learning about all these different artists and all these different songs. And that's when I realized, like, music really spoke to me. It's that one thing that like made me feel alive, you know. Yes. And then when I was a kid, I heard a bunch of early Michael Jackson stuff, and like, you know, it just gave you that good feeling energy, and I loved it.
Yeah. So you know, my next question was going into, but you really answered it right there. It was, what was it about the music that captured your attention? And so it made you feel alive. And I understand that also. It makes music is the greatest thing to me. It's a time machine. I love music. I have to have it every day.
Oh, dude, it's the ultimate healer.
Yeah.
If you put music on and you can, you know, it picks your mood up. It wakes you up. It makes you feel a certain way. It triggers different memories throughout your lifetime. It motivates. It energizes. It heals.
Man, oh man, listen, you just summed it up perfectly, because I feel exactly the same way, my brother. I mean, exactly the same way. So you play guitar. So what was it about guitar that screamed your name like no other instrument?
I mean, to me, I think guitar is the coolest looking instrument and like the most interesting one. It's just, it's the sexiest instrument of them all. Is it not?
That's awesome.
And then you know, like, I started, you know, as a kid, I joined band, right?
Right.
It came up, and I was like, yeah, I want to be a part of the band. but I wanted to play guitar.
Right.
And my family was like, no, no, we're not going to do that. You're not gonna stick with it anyway. So pick a different instrument. And I'm like, no, but I want to play guitar. Right. My grandpa was like, it's loud, it's expensive, you're not gonna stick with it. I told you, I don't want no son of mine being a musician, so no.
Really? Wow.
Right? It was a reoccurring theme. It happened like probably 3 or 4 times in my lifetime until like he said that my doorway, what we featured in the movie, and then like my grandmother lending me the money to buy the guitar and me having to hide it
right.
for a couple of months. Well, the doorway scene, I had it, right? And then, so like having to hide it, and then he finds out, and then he like tells me I'll never do it. And that was like, that was the final piece of like inspiration.
Right.
I needed to say, to hell with everybody.
Right.
I'm going to do this at all costs. And, you know, being an angry teenager trying to figure out life.
Yeah.
That was just right place, right time. Wrong thing to say, but right thing to say. Right. If that makes sense.
Of course it makes sense. That was your ultimate motivation.
But see, my dad, even though he motivated negatively like that, I think he knew that about his kid.
Okay, I got you.
He absolutely knew that if he pushed me enough in one way, he knew I would get mad.
Yes.
But he knew that would motivate.
I got you. I like that. I like that perspective of it. And you know, that allows you to even get more energy from that also and understanding that. So no, that's cool. So let me ask you this, digging a little deeper into that. Describe to us the sensation you get from playing guitar.
Oh man, it's I find that if I don't play guitar every day, like, I don't feel good. Like, I'm stressed out. I'm anxious. I feel like it's just a cathartic release. And to me, it's like just like we said, listening to music is healing.
Right.
Playing music has that same effect.
I got you.
And, like, it instantly makes me feel good about myself.
Awesome. Awesome. That's a great way to explain that. I love that. I love that. So now I want to talk about this, and I hope you don't mind. I want to get into the cerebral palsy part. So
yeah,
you having cerebral palsy brings a unique point of view to the music, to me, one of true triumph and inspiration. So your ability to overcome a disability and create this awesome band is very admirable to me. So what would you say has been the hardest part of your musical journey since 2008?
Staying consistent and getting people to take us seriously.
Mm.
Getting the industry to take us seriously in a sense of like backing us. You know, right. We're still looking for that one national level band that has a decent audience in front of them to take us out and right. give us a chance to spread our wings to a larger audience.
Yes.
And really kind of kickstart everything for us. Because we've had a lot of great experiences. We've dropped a couple records. We've toured a lot. We've done a ton of things, but we still need to hit that kickstart point, you know?
Right. You want to let them know that you can show up and show out just like they can. I understand that clearly. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
You're ready for that. So when it comes to the production and writing of lyrics, is it a team effort or one or two main creators?
Okay. So in my early explanations of the Mendenhall experiment, I'm going to refer to that as like the self-titled first record, right? Mm-hmm. The one that we did with Mario Valadez that right. has James Monkey Schaefer feature mm-hmm. and the Danny Roeder feature and all that. So right. during that recording process and writing those songs, there were points where it was a group effort, like myself, not myself as a main, but our vocalist as the main, Mario Valadez, and then our background vocalist and guitarist, Mike Lira.
Right.
They bounce ideas off of each other, and then every once in a while, I would hear what they were putting together, and I was like, well, what if you do it like this? Or what if you add this? Or what if you do that? Like, I would throw my hat into the lyrical mix.
Of course.
That was the first record. But Against the Odds with Elise Hayes, our female vocalist, she took it, ran with it, did her own. That's 100% her.
Okay.
Ain't nobody can say I helped write that. I had a hand in that. Nothing. That's all her.
Oh, okay. Awesome. That's love, love, love. So how important is it to have a great team behind you?
Oh, it's everything. It's everything. You know that as well as I do.
Yes.
Like with your history and the things that you've achieved, like you get that right combination of a team behind you, and it can make or break you.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. 100%. So let's talk about the Warped Tour battle of the bands. What do you feel this did for TMX, man?
Man. It taught us a lot. It taught us a lot that, like, okay, we learned that Battle of the Bands, 90% of them are fixed.
Yeah. Okay.
And I'm going to go on record and blow everybody out the water. Like, y'all are fixing that shit. Everybody knows that. We learned. And we should have won that competition, but they had predetermined that that band was going to win. And they bought all of their tickets and handed them out to fans. And we sold a bunch, but we didn't sell as many as they did, obviously.
Right.
They gave the competition to a different band. So we learned that. But through that whole experience, the reason why I bring that up is that, man, we did our thing at the House of Blues in Anaheim. And we ended the set, and they were literally chanting TMX, TMX, TMX.
Yes.
Like, they literally had to pull us off the stage. They had to kick our vocalist off, like, gotta bring the other band on, right?
Yeah.
So the other band, the band that won, came on, and they're kicking into their first song, right? And we're sitting in the green room, which was right off of the stage, basically.
Right.
And they're about a quarter of the way into the first song, and we're sitting back there, and we're going, TMX, TMX, all through this band's first song. So we actually got up and walked out of the green room, and you could see us walk to the side of the stage.
Right.
We all just kind of stood there with our mouths open, like, how are we not winning this? How,
right.
Like, we did it. Like, we're going to work through it. We're going to play this festival slot. We were stoked.
Right.
And we came down that, no, that band won, and we found out later how everything went, but it was predetermined and all that. But about a week after that, the label that we signed with, Lucent Records, called us and said, hey, we had one of our guys see you guys' performance at the House of Blues. Won't you guys come down and talk to us? So we did. We went back and forth a bunch. You know how that goes.
Yes.
But we ended up signing with them, and it changed our career.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, look, that segues right into it. And listen, beautiful story, man. I am a very super visual person, and I can see all of that when you're saying your mouths were gaped open and just looking at it. But that feeling had to be an amazing feeling of everybody just cheering and screaming for TMX. That is, I have a quick story for you. We went on before Good Charlotte at the Bacon and Eggs Festival when I was with Stuck Mojo. And yeah. They asked us to play like 10 extra minutes because they weren't ready yet. And we played about maybe 15. But the thing was, is that it was like one of the greatest times I've ever had on stage. And the crowd was cheering because Rich was talking about this young lady that was coming across named Helga. And so we had a whole crowd cheering Helga, and just it was amazing. So when Good Charlotte got on, the crowd continued to scream Helga. Helga, the lead singer was like, "What the hell is Helga? What's going on?" You know, they were still, you know, into what we had brought. We had brought an energy. And somebody told us that we saved that festival. And it was just like one of the greatest feelings to have those people so into what we were doing. So I hear you clearly, man.
Yeah, and for that, like, that moment will forever be one of my favorite moments in our career. Because, like I said, we've done a lot of things, but every now and then you get a moment like that, and you're just is this real? Like, the only one that instantly comes to mind when I say that is when we played the big Aftershock Festival the second time, and the one that's featured in the film, and all like 20,000 people in front of us. The whole time I remember looking over at Nathan, my bass player, and we're just playing and smiling ear to ear, and just that feeling of like, is this really is this real? Like, we're doing it, and they're eating out of our hands. Awesome. And like, this is magical. And that's what rules. That's the best thing about music is when you lock in with the audience and you can feel that magical exchange between them and you and them and you.
That's right.
And once you do it and you've been there, it's kind of hard to explain to somebody.
Yeah.
I'm sure you can relate.
Yeah, it's a transference of energy from you to them and them to you. And man, it just takes you to another level. And man, it just lifts you, man. And like, everybody becomes the moment. You're not in the moment. You're not, you know, this is the moment. No, you are the moment, and they are the moment. Yeah, and that's a beautiful thing, man. Yes, indeed. So Liquid Bit Music Productions and Lucent Records, who you say you signed with. So you said they were integral. You know, how integral have they been to your success? And you said they were very important to you.
They got us a distribution deal with Universal Music.
Universal, right.
And that was and has been instrumental in helping getting the industry and different connections and avenues throughout our career.
Yes.
People take us seriously. It makes us valid. These guys are with Universal. People want to talk to us. People like yourself, you know? Yeah.
Indeed.
It probably just makes us, it solidifies it.
Awesome. Awesome. So how much do you feel you've grown since your first recordings to the present release of your awesome song, Say It?
I mean, I feel like the answer to that question is clearly in the music. Mm-hmm. And like, you listen to the first record, and I still believe in that album. I believe we made the best album we could make at that time period. But you listen to those songs versus Against the Odds and the stuff that we're putting out now that's going to be on Chasing Ghosts, is that you can hear that we've all grown as musicians. Like,
right.
the songs musically are, there's just more to it. Okay. They're more defined. They're more refined. There's more to them. You can tell that we've grown into our own as musicians. Right.
And the reason why I like to ask that question, because a lot of times people are like, you know, the more that you grow and mature, to me, things should be more refined. They should be more polished. But, you know, a lot of people still like that. Oh, I like that rugged and raw when it first came out and, you know, it was so authentic. Well, it's still authentic. It's just better produced. It just sounds, the clarity is better. You know, some people like that griminess of it, but listen, I love the polish, to be honest with you.
I mean, and what a lot of people don't realize is that, like, those grimy first records for any band.
Right.
It's honestly kind of like molded out of necessity, right? A lot of those records sound grimy because they're not going to the right people. They only have access to,
right,
you know, certain people, certain recording studios, certain producers, which give you access to certain gear. Maybe they're limited budget-wise, you know, and they're just trying to get their art out there. So it's grimy, it's gritty, it's not well produced. But then, you know, when you get the ball rolling and you learn how things go, then things become evolved, they're more refined. And you get the fan bases that are like, oh, I wanted to go back to that. And it's like, but you can't go back. Right. Let's be real. You can't go back. Like, right. You're asking yourself to regress. Like, that doesn't make logical sense.
Right. It's something like Jay-Z said, you want to hear the old Jay-Z, go listen to the old Jay-Z music.
Yeah, like you want to hear the original Korn, go listen to that record. You want to hear, like, grimy TMX, go put on the first record. Like, it's there for you.
100%.
On repeat, you know?
That's right, indeed.
But by the same token, like, when we wrote the songs that became Against All Odds, a lot of those songs were kind of flushed out between me and our producer, Chris Collier.
Right.
And they were done almost complete, not lyrically, but musically. They were mostly done, a bulk of it was done about 3 years before they saw release.
Right, got you.
When the movie Mind Over Matter, when we made the film,
yes,
it tied our hands because the movie took an additional 3 years of, like, to get it to actually come out to the public.
Right.
As a band, we weren't allowed to release anything new,
right?
Because we didn't want our new catalog to outdate the movie. Right, we wanted the movie to come out and have it the most current thing. So we kind of stalled out as musicians, and that caused a bunch of internal strife and conflict. And, you know, because as much as my bandmates were behind the movie and thought it was great, they also felt like it was a movie about me and not primarily about the band. You know what I mean?
I got you.
So there was a lot of internal stuff. And then so we had written the songs and they were kind of sitting there and flushed out with me and Chris Collier, the producer, and even myself, I was like, yeah, I don't know if they feel like TMX songs. Because at that time period, our producer, Chris, he pushed me so much as a musician. Kind of helped us evolve into what you hear on on Against All Odds, that it took me a while for my brain to catch up to that evolution. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And so, I don't know, if I can teach anybody through that whole experience, is like, that's what a great producer will do for you. is take you, push you out of your comfort zone,
right,
into something like new growth. And trust me, sometimes that new growth is painful and doesn't feel comfortable. It doesn't feel right. But all I can say is trust the process.
Indeed. Hey, look, and it's turned out magnificent, young man. Indeed. And, you know, mind over matter, I'm glad you spoke about it. And just like you saying, you know, where they were thinking that it was more about you. But, you know, even if it was, that was, you know, this is an entertainment thing that we're in. And, you know, what's going to bring eyes and ears to the music, the great music that you're creating and stuff. And it's hard to keep a, you know, a band together. You know, it really is with all the different personalities and things like that, man. So, you know, this music industry is something else, but it's just something that we respect and we love. And I'm glad that you spoke about that. I really do. So let me, before I go into this next thing, with the present state of music being what it is, what do you prefer creating, singles, EPs, or albums?
Oh, man, that's a great question. So, okay, how do I want to approach this? Because I feel very, very strongly about this.
Okay.
Okay, so if you look at the career of the Mendenhall Experiment, and you can do that very simply by just going on Spotify and going to the bottom and following it up to
right.
Okay. We want to give the fans, eventually, we want to give the fans and our audience an album.
Mm-hmm.
Because that's one thing that we haven't done as a band, is right. deliver a full-length LP to the public.
Mm-hmm.
Me, as a musician and a music lover and enthusiast, who loves that album experience, getting the vinyl, putting it on the vinyl player, looking at the artwork while the music is playing.
Yes.
I love it.
Right.
And we want to give that experience to our audience.
Right.
However, hold on, I don't want to lose you.
You good? You good?
However, like, we also, or I, realize that the current climate of the music industry
right.
is no longer geared for that. And so that's what we did with Against the Odds and the EP that's going to be Chasing Ghosts. We went into the studio and recorded 10 songs.
Right.
With the intention of just dropping an album. And I was very adamant in the studio, we gotta get 10 because we gotta do the record.
Mm-hmm.
And then by the time we cut the record, and just looking at the market trends, looking at the industry, and going, looking at the amount of money we paid for it.
Right.
The bottom line, and going, as much as me personally wanting to give the fans an album,
mm-hmm.
I had to make the business decision to chop that in half.
Right.
And release two EPs.
Gotcha.
Because the industry nowadays is all about that timeline of consistency.
That's right.
You releasing music on a consistent schedule and then touring and doing all the band and musician things that people do, right? So we chopped it, we split it, we've got singles and EPs and two EPs. So now we're gonna, by the end of the summer, we should have a trilogy of EPs out to the public.
Got you.
Which is cool, but it's not that long play album.
Right.
But will we ever get there? Yeah, I think so. Because, like, I think eventually I'm just going to get a case of the it's and just say it and just go, let's just put it out.
And right, indeed.
It.
No, I got it, man. No, great answer, man. Yeah, yeah. Thank you for that, man. I love that. And that's, I love your honesty on that, indeed. So let's get into your lineup. So your present lineup consists of you, of course, Mr. Brandon Mendenhall, rhythm guitarist. We've got Alice Hayes, vocalist. Mike Lira. Am I saying it's Lyra or Lira?
Lira.
Lira. Okay, lead guitarist. Sorry, Mike. Nathan Stockton, bassist. Correct. So he's, and the thing with him also, so he overcame deafness also, correct?
I don't know if, and I've seen this in a lot of press, mm-hmm. is that I don't know if overcoming deafness is the political correctness way of saying it.
Uh-huh.
Maybe that's something that we gotta flush out as a team, because obviously he's still very much like hearing impaired and right. vision impaired. He's okay. got like 3% hearing in one ear and 8 or 12% in
got you.
In the other ear. He's got hearing aids, and his vision is what they call Usher syndrome. So mm-hmm. he has like cornal tunnel vision. So his vision is like coned.
Okay.
So he can't see far left, far right, can't really see right in front of him.
Mm-hmm.
You gotta get like right up on him for him to see like a clear right. image. And dude, it's hard, man. It's yeah. hard. And over the past 5 years, we've watched Nathan and his condition get a lot worse.
Right.
And it's hard. You know, Nathan has 2 teenage daughters at home. And he's super adamant about this band and mm-hmm. and doing what we do and bringing a message to the people. But we, especially when we tour, we watch him struggle. Like we see how challenging he is. And I know in the press, it's a lot about my story, but and Nathan's story kind of it gets mentioned, but it never really gets talked about. He's not really a talker like I am, mm-hmm. but it needs to be vocalized a lot more. This dude is really going through it, really, really like putting his heart and soul into the music and mm-hmm. showing up for us. And you know, I've always told him, man, you have a home here as long as you want to. As long as you want to be here, you're here.
Right.
But I think we all realize that there's probably going to come a day that he's going to be like, I can't do this. Or I don't want to do this any further because I want to go and enjoy the rest of my, like,
yes,
time I have left with what hearing I have left, what vision I have left. You know, and he's already kind of been doing that. He's taking as much family time as he can get. Yes. Anything outside of the band is Nathan going and living his life to the fullest. And we support that 1,000,000%.
Well, Brandon, very well said. And that's, I'm glad you expounded on it because, you know, I did bring it up because I did see those kind of parallels of you and he in the same, you know, same sense, overcoming things and playing music. I had a young man, David Perry, is it Fear of Water? Great, great artist. And he overcame deafness also. So when I saw that, you know, and his story about overcoming deafness and how it happened with him and the thing that he had, it was just as amazing as what you're saying right here. To hear your stories and see that you guys are overcoming these challenges and being able to play music at a high level, at a very great level, is just, once again, is admirable to me. And I enjoy it. And I'm thankful and that you are open to speak about it. I really do. I think it'll change people. I think it will as you say, you guys are about inspiring and inspiration. And I think it's a great thing, bro. And I really appreciate it.
Oh man, Nathan, you know, Nathan gets razzed and teased by the band a lot, you know, the stereotypical rock band bass player dynamic, and we razz on him a lot of time, but it's all like joking good fun. You know, oh, he's just a bass player, but honestly, Nathan is like, Nathan's a more talented musician than me.
Right.
Like, I can watch him, like, just hear something a couple of times, and he picks it up right away. Mm-hmm. Where I have to sit with something for 2 weeks before I fully pick it up.
Right, right. Wow, man. Well, shout out to Nathan, man. You know, much respect to him, no doubt about it, man. Thank you for that. I really enjoyed that conversation right there, that part of it. I really did.
Sick.
So the next person would be Justin Lubeck, percussionist, right? And so, so here's what I want to ask you is that what does each member bring to the band that makes them so special to you?
Just, they're all great people, and, mm-hmm. and they all bring different, like you said, different aspects, like, and really different musical backgrounds.
Uh-huh.
But then we all just come together and, like, we make this thing, the Mendenhall experiment. So I think that's what's great is, like, and we're friends, too. There's not a lot of bands these days where people are just, you know, socially friends.
Right.
So I think Justin he's a heavy hitter. He's a heavy drummer. He has a sense of like off tempo that he incorporates, and just with Justin having grown up with him in high school, I think that's a big allure to me as well, is to play music with somebody that I grew up with. And then Nathan being blind and deaf and being the talented bass player that he is, you know, he's obviously the right choice to fill that spot. And he has a thunderous bass sound, which I love that. Mm-hmm. And and then Mike Lehrer on lead guitar, if Mike's personality, Mike has this overwhelming outwards going personality. He's always positive. He always wants to have like 25 people around him at all times. Right. I call him the Fieldy of our band, because what I mean by that is he always has an entourage. And if you knew Fieldy from the corn days, he always has, you know, 10, 15, 20 people around him. So Mike is definitely the Fieldy of our band. He's always got a house full of people. We've always planned some social get together. And Mike's a great, on top of everything, Mike's a great songwriter. Mike is, when it comes to guitar and the songs that we write, like, he understands what this band needs musically.
Mm.
And so that coupled with his great personality of, like, you know, wanting to just be positive and have people around, it's a good mix. And then you get to me some vocals and, I mean, she opens her mouth and that's it. She has a very beautiful, beautiful voice.
She does, indeed.
but I will say this about Elise. The one thing that I think that she brings to this band that makes it so special, and I don't even think she realizes it sometimes, is that she is bringing a vocal style and an approach to a band, a metal band like us,
Mm-hmm.
that hasn't been done and hasn't been showcased in the industry. She has very much like a touch of like that Detroit Motown soulful kind of delivery and essence to her. And I don't think that's been, that type of female vocal hasn't been delivered to the industry yet.
Gotcha.
Like, you've got the female vocal that like comes out and like, they do the singy thing and then they do the screamy thing and they try to match the dudes, and that's been done to death. But you've never, to current day, I can't think of anyone who's taken a metal band and put kind of a soulful approach over the top.
Right, right. Yeah, because I see that, you know, she likes Tina Turner also. So, you know, I can see that, man. You spoke well about that also, man. Nah, that's love. I do want to ask a quick question, though. How was it to have the change of vocalist? So you had male at first, strong vocals, and now you have this female. So what's the dynamic? You know, you've spoken about what she brings to it, but how is that change? How is that vibe different?
That came about because obviously Mario Valadez had Irish twins, so he had two babies 9 months apart. It was time for him to go be a father and take care of you, and we had to go be a rock band, and that was it. So we knew that we had to make a change, and I felt that. I don't immediately want to go out and find another male vocalist to replace or replicate what Mario had done. Right. I was like, what if we grab a female and let Mario live in kind of his own space-time continuum chapter of the band and take a new approach, have a female vocalist.
Right.
Continue on, obviously, still play all of the songs in the catalog.
Yeah.
But kind of a rejuvenated twist, you know?
Gotcha.
And
gotcha.
I knew it would work, but we didn't know how well.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, Elise came down and tried out, and, we ran through Seize the Day a couple of times, and I had my ball cap on, kind of baseball curve. Got my head down, and I'm playing, and I'm kind of, she's just singing, and I'm just grinning, trying to hide my face, like, because I knew.
You know.
And literally, it kind of hit that point. You know, when he left to go do his own thing, he also kind of hit that point of like physical exhaustion. Like, he had a lot of things going on in his life, and he kind of hit that ceiling of just being exhausted. And it was just rejuvenating to hear somebody come in and nail those songs and hit notes so beautifully. And we ran with it.
That's awesome. Yeah, it sounds great, man. And listen, I'm not sure if I said Allison. You said it's Elise, correct?
Elise,
I apologize to you. Forgive me, Elise. Forgive me, young lady. So
we get it all the time. We get Elise.
Yeah. And listen, the person that I am, I like it to be right and proper, man. So, you know, I apologize.
We get the Mendenhall experience. We get the Mendenhall project. We get it all, baby.
So, your videos and shows highlight your incredible energy and love for music. What do you enjoy more, creating the music or performing the music?
Absolutely 100% playing live. I like being on stage. I like being on tour. I like giving it to the people. Getting up there, physically playing, getting off stage, talking to people, being the social butterfly and inspiring people face to face. I call it I call it hand-to-hand combat.
Well, I listen, but tell me about when you fell on stage, man.
Which time?
But look, I mean, just the one, the video I saw, I was just like, yo, what's the deal, man?
Are you talking about the, are you talking about the video, the clip in Detroit where where I went right head first?
Yes, yes.
So, okay, I'll tell the backstory on this. So if you guys ever go to Detroit or right outside of Detroit, there's a venue called the Diesel Concert Lounge. And this was last July, we were there. And it was our headline tour for Against the Odds. We were in the main room. We had this huge, huge stage.
Yeah.
And we, every so often we get a stage like that, right?
Yeah, yeah.
But I had a new wireless system. We had the full stage for ourselves. We had the backdrop going. We had everything, and I was super stoked. So, and Elisa's family were all in the audience. We had ten of her family members because she's from the Detroit area.
Detroit area, okay. So
it was family and friends were there, and we kicked into Breaking Out, I think, was like the first song, 30 seconds in, and I chose to overperform my cerebral palsy physical ability. I'm up there playing, and in my head, I'm going, okay, do that left hand spin turn thing, like, you know, Monkey from Corn does that left-handed turn thing and kind of it. In my head, that's what I was trying to do. But I went left and my cerebral palsy went, nope. I go left and then I count correct and then I go right to the drum rifle.
Right.
And it bags. That rang my bell.
Dude. Oh, did it? I'm sorry for laughing, man. I just
like you can see in the video. I knock him. I'm like knocking on the drum leather. Like I'm knocking on the door because I knocked on it to see if it was sturdy enough for me to like push my body.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
And people have asked me about that. They're like, why are you knocking on my drum riser? I'm like, because I want to know how much weight I can pull.
Well, indeed.
You're not thinking the drums and my drummers up there. But
in the moment,
going, am I pressing on something that's going to give out on me?
Yeah. But then again, you said you rung your bell. You know, that wasn't easy, you know?
And then I get up and I'm like, Justin was like, dude, you pushed my drum set like a foot backwards.
Wow.
With your head.
Wow.
And he's like, I look at you and I'm like, oh man, is this it? Did we stop playing?
Right.
And he goes, you popped right up. You got right up and you just kept playing. And he goes, I saw that. And I go, all right, he's all right. But I got up and I'm playing. And my guitar tech that was out with us got my attention, and he's like, dude, get out. Get out. He's like, your guitar is done.
Right, what tone? Yeah.
I'm like, no one can sound like shit. And I'm just going, that in my head, I'm like, come on, that hurt. That really hurt.
Yeah, yeah.
And then of course you're embarrassed too. Or I was like, damn, I look like an idiot.
No, you didn't look like an idiot. It happens. Man, listen, I busted my ass on stage before, and I'm a big guy. And I was like, boop, all of a sudden bam, I'm on my back. But all I did, I just laid there for a moment and I laughed and I just kept going on because the show must go on. And you did that. So there's nothing to it. Nothing to be embarrassed about, man. You handled your business, man.
you just gotta laugh it off and did swap my guitar real quick and
yeah.
He took it and like tuned it back up, and we swapped back to the main, and it was all good.
Awesome, man. And listen, you're a professional. What are you talking about? You're a professional. That's what it is. So you guys stay tremendously busy and just recently finished the Stand for Ourselves tour. So how enjoyable was that tour for you?
You want to talk about being professional and having perseverance, mm-hmm. and pushing through an injury. That tour will always be special for me for a lot of things, but I can't not talk about that. I went on the tour with a hip injury. Because Nathan, my bass player, and I, we joined a bowling league together to have something to do that wasn't musical related.
Right.
On an off time, kind of like a whole like team building, bonding. Because after you're in a band with somebody for like 10 years,
right,
you know, that relationship can kind of become strained, and you know, everything becomes about the music, and then your friendships kind of get lost in the wash sometimes. Right. So Nathan and I said, hey, now that we're just doing tours, we got a booking agent, we're just touring, we have more downtime than we used to have.
Yes.
He goes, why don't we do this? Why don't you join the bowling league with me? So we did that. And then I get hurt. I blew out my hip.
Yes.
My left hip, I like strained, or my hip flexor. I think I just strained it because I haven't had to have surgery. I refused the MRI because I don't have insurance like that.
Right.
So going to physical therapy, on medication, working it out, got a walker, right? But I went on tour like that with a walker. I couldn't stand and play.
Yeah.
So what I did was I came up with the idea. I was like, well, let's just take the 2x12 EVH cabinets that we were double stacked on our 4x12.
Mm-hmm.
Stacked them up, and then I just kind of straddled the corner of it.
Yeah.
Threw my bad leg up over the top and kind of stood there and
made it
and
work.
Hit that way. And it worked. It worked. It did not hinder my performance musically one bit. Obviously, performance energy wise, I'm not roaming around the stage and interacting in that way, but musically it was there 100%.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. So,
but how many guys do you know in the music industry that would know that they're injured and still go on tour?
Hey, I'm with you, and it's very few, believe it. You know, you have a love for the music, man, that's unparalleled, man. And once again, I salute you, man. That's a great thing. So,
but also talking about the tour, we have to talk about how great that tour was,
mm-hmm.
and how like the guys that Scream at the Sky. Anybody who hasn't heard these guys in Scream at the Sky, I implore you to go look them up, get into what they're doing, because what they're building is definitely going to become something of stature. Brian, the main dude, Brian Carter, he came from a band called Dead Horse Trauma, and they were killing it for a few years, and then they decided to disband, and Brian said, well, I don't want this to be the end of my musical prowess, so he went out and created Scream of the Sky for himself, and chose to sing and play guitar. He has a great couple of guys, band behind him.
Right.
Bundy on bass and Dave on drums. And, you know, they're just great, positive, good energy human beings. And, like, you know, Bundy basically carried me on and off stage every night.
Right.
And when do you know a headline band to help out their opener in the way that they helped us out. They didn't have to do that, but they did. They're great people.
It's awesome that you said that. Just like my man Ryan Ross from band Vengeance from Napa, California.
Dude, so wait. This is what I wanted to talk about. And I don't know if you realize, do you know that we know each other?
Who, you and I?
Okay, this is gonna blow your mind. Like, really gonna blow your mind.
Okay.
Like, probably freak you out. Like, so, and I don't know if I'm gonna be able to get it out of my mouth. I'm so excited. But Ryan from, and the guys from the guys from Vengeance were the very first band to ever, like, take me on tour. I went out with them in 2007 all across the country.
Right.
And I did merch for them. I don't know if you know that.
I don't know that.
And I knew that you did vocal. Didn't you mend some vocal talent?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Like a Vengeance song or.
Yeah, we did a song together.
An Angela song? Was it Vengeance or was it Angela?
No, it was Vengeance. Yes, indeed.
So I knew that Ryan knew you and had worked with you. He talked about you a lot on tour.
Yeah.
And I think you were a huge influence on him and obviously stuck mojo on us.
Right.
You guys were pioneers of a sound and of a grit that can't be denied. But yeah, like, Vengeance took me, they were the first band to take me on tour. 2007, we did almost 5 weeks around the country.
Oh, really? Yes.
Didn't know those guys at all. Flew up from LA to Sacramento.
Yeah.
Hopped in a van with them. I was so young. I was barely, I think I was 22 years old at the time.
Right.
And I was still kind of like sheltered, like, maybe I was a little bit older, I think 23, 24 maybe, but it doesn't matter. I was still young and sheltered and here, I didn't know these dudes. Like, I knew, but how I got connected with them was I bonded with one of my instructors at Full Sail University.
Mm-hmm.
In Florida, where I went to production school.
Yes.
He knew, I believe he knew, I think it was Ryan or maybe Father, mm-hmm. one of the guys. I think it was Ryan.
Right.
Rave. And he goes, hey, Ryan, I got this student of mine. You should, he really wants to tour. At the time, I wanted to go on tour as a production assistant with Korn and kind of break my career that way,
right.
Make a bunch of connections and stack money to not only pay off my student loans, but like to set myself up for life.
Yes.
So the whole thing was, why don't you take this dude on tour, right?
Mm-hmm.
And give him some touring experience. So I flew to Sacramento, didn't know him. They picked me up, hopped in the van, didn't say anything for the first 30 minutes of we drove from the airport to like the rehearsal space. I was just so like not, I was socially introverted back then.
Right.
So I was like not scared, but I was just like, this is like jumping off of a bridge,
right.
of my
zone.
Yeah. A million percent. So I get in the van with them, we go to the rehearsal spot, and I hop out. And I remember meeting the whole band for the first time. And they were going to jam, and then we were going to load up all the gear and drive to the first gig.
Yes.
That was it. So How about my mom looking at me, and I found out years later that my instructor never told Ryan.
Never told him.
Never told Ryan that I have cerebral palsy.
Right.
At all. Didn't tell him. So I hop out, the whole band's looking at me. I'm like, we gotta take this guy to it. Like, what's this dude's deal?
Right.
And then over the course of the next couple of weeks, we all connected the dots.
Man, that is a great story. And I'm gonna tell you something. Those guys, and I mean every single one of them, they are my brothers. I love them so much. We toured together. Ryan and I were born on the same day. We hung out for a month in Europe, and I get emotional about it, man, because those guys, we had such a great time together, and I learned a lot from them. I learned about their hustle and their grind and their grit, and you know, when you say that about you guys went on tour, Ryan has such an amazing story. He should write an amazing book about the things that he's done in his life and the band and just traveling and doing things. And he's one of the best human beings in the world. And he and Hell B, they said that we just need better human beings in this world. And so when you say that, Ryan is one of those, all of them are really those great human beings. And they received me being that fill in for Bones for Stuck Mojo, and they just embraced me, and it was just love from the jump. And I have the utmost respect for every one of them. And Ryan, listen, Ryan flew me out to California to be the officiant for he and his wife. So I married them. Yes.
Yeah. Wow. And I didn't know that.
And listen, you want to talk about that's my guy, man. I love his entire family. You know, I do anything for him if he needed it. And man, he's just really one of the great ones. They all are. And I mean, every single one of them are great. And they've shown me nothing but love, man. And the song we did was Changing of the Guard on their album. And hey, man, that's a great story, man. You got me in my feelings, bro.
Bro, man, I can tell you that very first tour, Going out with Vengeance, like, man, I still pull things I've learned from them. And, right. And they taught me how to tour.
Yes.
They taught me how to tour. They taught me, like, the parking lot pimping, going to a Walmart, walking around with a pocket full of CDs.
Yes.
Selling albums to random people, you know. Going out and getting people to come to your merch table and buy your stuff and you know, the load out, all the aspects of like what it's like to be out in a band. How do you save money on food? Oh. How do you save money on hotels? Like, you know, the breakdown. Like, we were 6 hours in and the van blew the radiator in Redland. Wow. And then, like, we got to New York and we were stranded in Poughkeepsie for 3 days.
Wow.
So we went and hung out with the mechanic for 3 days while they waited for transmission parts.
Yes.
And the expenses and the nightmare of that whole scenario. And then it wasn't easy, man. That tour broke me. Like, I went out with them and like they were not very nice to me.
Mm-hmm.
They were very hard on me, especially Ryan at times,
mm-hmm.
because he wanted to teach me and mold me for the industry.
Yes.
And like, we were about 2 weeks in and I wanted to quit. Like,
mm-hmm.
they broke me. And I was like, I'm done. These guys suck. Like, this is not a comfortable experience. This is not what I want.
Yes.
And like, I called my buddy in LA and I was like, what would I do, man? Tell me what to do here, because like, I'm having a rough time. And he goes, dude, this is what you want in life, right? This is what you want to do. And he goes, then you gotta suck it up.
Yes.
Because you can't You can't come home. You cannot come home. You have to suck it up, and you have to persevere, and you have to do this.
Yes, indeed.
And I did. And to this day, there's been no other experience that has taught me so much in one small period of time.
That, listen, man, I'm telling you, I got goosebumps so crazy. It is so awesome because, as you said, I watched them hustle and grind and do their thing, and I was amazed at it, and I loved it. I loved their work ethic. I was just like, you guys, so I don't, there's a movie, Trading Places with Eddie Murphy and Dan Aykroyd. I don't know if you know that movie.
Yeah,
it's
an older
movie. But
no, I've seen it.
Yeah, so you remember when the Duke brothers were like, sell, sell, sell. So I used to say that to them every night. So I was like, sell, sell, sell. And they sold CD after CD, and they got out there. And I just, man, I applauded them. And I just thought it was an amazing thing because that was that California thing, you know, like the rappers like Too Short and those people like that. That's what they did. They got out there and they sold it. And so they had that energy. And when I saw it, you know, I know we used to do the same thing here. I live on the East Coast, but it was like, when I saw it, I was just like, that's that California thing right there. And they were just at it. And I just, man, I'm telling you, man, I applaud those. They're my brothers, man. I love those dudes, man.
During that whole period, Ryan kind of broke my balls. And when we were standing in New York, we went to New Hampshire Beach for the whole Boardwalk Coastline. And they got in the room, and I was hanging out with the bass player the night before. We were drinking, having a good time, you know, being one of the boys.
Yeah.
And Ryan was like, he got on me. He was like, dude, you hear the work. Like, why are you hanging out with my band, like, drinking a beer? Like, you're supposed to work. Like, and dude, he broke me down really bad.
Yeah.
And I remember going to sleep at night, and I was pissed, I was sad, I was upset. I didn't know what I wanted to do. And I got up at 6 a.m. the next morning, I grabbed a stack of Vengeance CDs,
right,
put 5 in each one of my cargo pockets of my shorts, and I got my hat and I went down to the boardwalk. And I walked up and down the boardwalk of New Hampshire, that beach area.
Yeah.
And I sold every one of those fucking CDs.
Awesome.
And I came back. It was like 10 or 11 in the morning. And they were just kind of getting up, rustling. I came back and I threw the money on the table. And I said, they're like, what's this? I said, I sold 10 CDs. And he looked at me and I was like, are we good now? Love those dudes. Love those dudes. A hustle like you would never believe. You have to know those guys to understand it.
Yeah.
Taking that attitude, and I've applied it to hopefully everything that we do.
Man, listen. That was, you know what I always say? That life lessons. That's what that was, a life lesson. And it has allowed you to take your career to another level. And you take it, listen, everything's not going to be easy and feel good. You know, I like for it to feel good and be easy, but it's not that way, especially in the music business. But, man, I'm telling you, I can just tell that you learned from that and you've grown from that.
You know what the hardest part for me was?
What's that?
About that entire experience. And I didn't even account for this when I took the gig and I went on the tour. Mm-hmm. Is that, like, the hardest part for me was I was a guitar player and I was a shy kid.
Right.
I didn't like to go up to people I didn't know and just start running my mouth. And then on top of it, I had the disability, so I was always kind of like self-conscious about my speech and my approach to people. So I was kind of in my head with that the whole the whole time. And it was a, that's what made it so difficult for me to kind of, and that whole experience was pushing through that, that barrier.
Right. Man, listen.
So I definitely learned like invaluable stuff from.
Man, that, listen, that's so awesome, man. That's so awesome. It really is. And listen, I can't wait. You know, I'm going to call him a little bit later and I'm going to mess with him.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know,
I'm definitely going to mess with him. Indeed. Great story, bro.
You know, I don't think we're on bad terms, but the last couple of times that I saw Ryan, things didn't end up the way that I wanted them to end up. Like they came and stayed at my apartment in Burbank for NAMM once, and that was kind of weird because my place was really small, and they came in with like 8 dudes.
Right.
And then like I had a knucklehead roommate that was like smoking weed out of a light bulb, and it looked like it looked like something else, and it wasn't, but like bad neighborhood, bad look. And Ryan kind of looked at me, I'm like, dude, it's not what you think. Right. And then so that was kind of weird. And then a few years after that, Andrew came down and played a show with us in LA. And that was the night that Mario decided to tell us that like he was having a baby, and that there was some drama going on with the movie, and he had gotten his own manager, and so there was kind of like this internal conflict of the band that happened like right after we played, and then NDR was on after us. And I had all the intention of the world of going in and showing all the love to my boy, fixing that relationship, right? And then the band explosion that happened after our set. I spent half of Andrew's set arguing with my singer on the sidewalk. And I was like, dude, my boy from Northern California is on stage right now. Like, why are you doing this tonight? We can't do this like later in the week. But you know how band things go. It happened. So I...
Brandon, hold on a second, Brandon. Hey, relent. What's going on, man? Listen, I'm having a great conversation. I wish I could hook it up. I knew what was up. I said, I got to go ahead and call you. I'm having a great conversation with one Brandon Mendenhall. And he just told me a story about you guys. Right, man. And listen, it is amazing. I wish I could have you. I just wanted to holler at you because, man, I just got emotional about it, man. I just tell him, I said, man, you know how much I love Ryan, man. Those are my brothers, man. Yeah, indeed. Well, look, I'll holler at you later, man. I just wanted to call you while I was on here with him, man. Record, man. But hey, he just had a great story about you. Can you hear him, Brandon?
I can't hear him. But
he can't hear me on the mic like
tell,
this. But
tell him that I said we gotta reconnect. It's been way too long.
Yeah, indeed. So we're gonna finish this up, but I'll call you a little later. You too, man. Be good. All right, peace. And I had to, man. I apologize, man.
No, I'm glad you did, man. Let's just keep it as organic as possible. Yeah. And last week when we were supposed to do this, like that whole connection was like on my mind. I was gonna kind of come out the gate with it, and then I had completely forgotten about it. I mean, you mentioned it. I'm so glad you mentioned it. Because if we were to be interviewing, forgot to talk about that, I would have been like, no way.
Oh, bro, listen, that was awesome. And once again, he said he calls you Moose. We calls you Moose. What?
Moose Dick.
That's what he said, Moose.
Moose Dick. And I tell people that I work with at Home Depot, I joke about that. I was like, you guys know my nickname is Moose Dick, right? Uh-huh. And I'm like, yeah, right, whatever. I'm like, no, really. Like the very first tour I went on, now he's texting me. actually, no, that's not Ryan. That's the publicist. Yeah. I was like, yeah, they nicknamed me Moose Dick. I was like, probably even because they think I'm well hung, or they just dick. Or maybe a little bit of both. But everybody in my crew had nicknames, so right. they carried on with the nicknames, you know, Flatline, Father, Relentless,
yes,
Dankman,
Hellbe, yes, indeed.
Dankman's like my evil twin, dude.
Yes, indeed.
you put him and I side by side, you can't tell the difference.
Yeah, listen, so I was going to tell you that. Yes, indeed. You guys do favor each other with the hair and everything. Thanks, my boy, man.
The hair, everything, kind of our personality, our style, our guitar, what we like to play, like our influences, dude. Like, that's my brother from another mother.
Yes, sir.
I love that, dude.
Amen. Listen, a great segment. I'm telling you, man, I might have to make this in two parts, man, two episodes, 1 week and then the next week, because this has just been awesome. And I still got more stuff to ask you, man. I'm enjoying this so much, man.
Well, we should do a roundtable, like kind of part two. We'll bring Relentless on here.
We'll do that next time, man. Listen, you're family now. And anytime you're ready to come back, we're good to go, bro. We're good to go. Yes, indeed. So let me ask you this. So with your positive mindset being a gigantic part of your foundation, how often do you receive love from those you've inspired to rise above unfavorable circumstances?
Every time we go out. Every time we go out, we are blessed and we are fortunate enough to have people come forward to us and share their testimonial of what my story and our band and the music that we're playing and the message that we're sharing with people.
Yes.
How important it is to them, to their personal lives, and to others around the world.
Yes, indeed.
And I think that's the number one thing that keeps us continuing to go out. We don't make a lot of money doing this. It's a giant hustle and a giant, like, teeter totter, pendulum. You gotta balance one side and give a little bit from the other side and it swings back and forth.
Right.
But that's the one thing that keeps us going, man. Is the people continuing to come forward and say, what you're doing is important and you have to keep doing it because you're changing people's lives, you're changing people's perspectives, and like, you help me, and you're gonna help other people as well.
Right.
And man, you can't ask for a greater gift than music. When I started this, I told myself if I could inspire one person to become inspired and want to overcome the challenges and or maybe play guitar because of me as a guitarist, then I won. Then it's all worth it. And I can honestly tell you today, I've had so many of those experiences with the success of the movie worldwide that I can't remember them all, but I cherish all of them.
Indeed.
And I respond to each and every one of these people.
Yes.
And I'll give you the shirt off my back.
Awesome.
That's just how I am. Like, I don't take any of that lightly.
It's awesome, bro. That's awesome. And once again, thank you for that. I really do appreciate that. So what does success look like to you?
That's a good question too, because I'm sure you know as well as I do, like, that changes as time goes on, right? Mm-hmm. As you age and you mature and you grow in life, your idea of what success is or what it means to you personally changes, right? Mm-hmm. So I think current day it is just, you know, continuing to be a successful musician, continuing mm-hmm. to inspire people and being able to be comfortable doing right. it mm-hmm. and like and just having your proverbial life together. It's kind of how I view success now. It's more about life experiences mm-hmm. and sharing things with your friends and family around me than it is material possessions or like career achievements. Mm-hmm. When I was a little bit younger, it was all about, you know, we got to play this festival, we got to play with this band, or we got to go on right. tour with this band or that band, or I got to have custom amps and custom guitars and endorsements and this, that, and all of that stuff is great.
Yes.
And that meant a lot to me when I was younger, but now I think it's kind of evolved into having stability and being able to have life experiences with your loved ones around you and really enjoying life.
Awesome, man. That's listen, man. Brandon, you that dude, man. I'm telling you, man. That's a great answer. I appreciate that. And I think you're one of the first people who really expressed it in that way, you know, because I asked that question. But, man, hey, definitely. Great answer, my brother. So what makes TMX a must watch and listen?
TMX is a must watch and listen because there's something in this band for everyone. Just like there's something in my movie, Mind Over Matter, for mm-hmm. everyone, I believe there's something that everyone can take away from my band and our band, our experiences, and what we bring to the audience. I mean, if you can't find yourself connected with what we're doing, check your pulse.
Right. Great, man. Great, great, my brother. Okay, so what can we expect from TMX for the rest of 2024?
Touring, and more touring. Yeah. We go out, we got 10 dates in July 10th through July 20th. Mm-hmm. We'll be out September 2nd through September 12th. And then we're working on a tour this fall. I don't really have the dates yet. Looking yeah. at like late October, early November, probably southeast. I want to hit that kind of Florida, yeah. East Coast, southern kind of area.
Yes.
In the fall, it will be warm, but not too warm.
Yeah.
So that's what we're kind of looking at. We're going to drop Chasing Ghosts, the mm-hmm. upcoming EP, before the end of the summer.
Right.
We dropped Obviously Say It came out, the latest single.
Mm-hmm.
Came out almost a month ago today, right? Yeah. What is today? Is today the 10th?
I believe so, yes.
So 1 month ago today, Say It came out. And the response has been good. It's been kind of slow, Kapuka are other releases, but I stand behind the song. I
Of
think it's
course.
one of the heaviest songs in her catalog. One of the songs that came together organically when usually we write in factions. That one came together as a whole band, and it came together real quick. And you know, when you have moments like that, like if there's magic in it. So I hope that there's something that people can really gravitate towards.
Indeed, and I think they will, man, because you guys have great music by great musicians. You all are, and I've enjoyed it, man, and it's amazing. And just like, you know, everybody's got to go out there and watch Mind Over Matter also, man. You're just doing your thing, bro, and continue success in all that you're doing. And just like I said, man, anytime that you want to come back, man, it's nothing. You don't have to knock or ring the bell. Just come on in, put your feet up, and let's talk about whatever you want to talk about, man. We're family. And it's a beautiful thing, and I thank you for your time. I really do, because I know your time is priceless. And so,
dude, I was stoked to come on when I saw it come up in my email. I hit up our publicist, and
Yashana,
I said, this is awesome. Yeah. I am super excited for this. I'm a fan of Stuck Mojo.
Yeah,
I knew that you knew Ryan. I was like, I'm gonna have a connection here, and. It's going to be a really good one.
Yes, sir.
It definitely was that.
Yeah. Sure. Listen. You got me in my emotions too, man. So I appreciate it, man. And not just with the Ryan thing, man. Just the whole, your whole story is one to be paid attention to and listened and watched. And I really appreciate it, Brandon. I really do.
And dude, I love how you made it all out and on the green screen behind you. I keep looking at it going, and we have done a lot of things.
Yeah, and I wanted it to be more, you know, certain things I could put and do, you know, just working it out. And it would have been a little more tighter if anyway, the app was messing up, but it's all love, man. You know, it's all good. But I'm glad that you enjoy it and you see it, because I want it to be about you, because it is about you 100%. And so
Let me ask you this, because I know you want to wrap this up and bring this thing to a close. Like, so I want to know, like, do you have any musical plans to do anything? Music? Are you doing anything? Like, you have a band, right?
100%. So I'm in a band called Plastic Catastrophe with Lord Nelson. We just released another single called No More. And we have a lyric video for it. And plus I got another little video I'm gonna put out in a little bit after that for the same song. But yes, you know, me and my brother, Matt Acevedo, I call him the Magnificent Matt Acevedo. He is an amazing musician, producer. He does it all for us. And yeah, we're doing our thing, man. And I was gonna tell you, man, we might have to, we're trying to work something out to where we can, cause he lives in Texas, to where we get together. Cause I want to do, you know, possibly some touring this year. And so,
let's go.
Indeed. And so, when we get there, we're working on getting that together. And man, you know, I want to go out and do a nice little run, man, because it'll be the first time with us doing a run. Because we did release an album called The Firestarters. So I have to send you that stuff, man, so you can check it out. But yeah, I'm busy. I'm definitely busy and enjoying it, man. So. Once again, it's called Plastic Catastrophe with Lord Nelson, and we're doing our thing.
I'm gonna go dig it up. I know. Before the interview last week, I did a deep dive on Stuck Mojo and kind of brushed up on the history and came into the band and all that. I was digging all that, and I know because members of Stuck played with. They ended up backing Fozzy, right?
Right. Yeah, Richards and Fozzy, right. A few other guys.
And then I met Chris Jericho when we did Rocklahoma.
Yeah, yeah.
In 2017, we met Chris, me and Mike Lair. We got to meet Chris.
Yeah.
The Monster Energy dude.
Right.
And interesting story about Chris.
Uh-huh.
Chris daughter that has cerebral palsy. I don't know if a lot of people know that. Maybe I shouldn't have said that.
you speak on it.
But But I guess Chris has a daughter with cerebral palsy, but he's worked hard with her to get her to stay physically on top of it. I think she's a lot like me, where it's kind of a mild case, kind of just working hard physically to overcome it as much as you possibly can.
Got you. Indeed. Indeed.
It was very, very interesting, but Chris is a very awesome dude.
Yeah, all of, man, listen, all those dudes, man, all those dudes are my brothers, man. It's all love. It's all love. We don't talk to each other like we used to talk to each other, but anytime we do talk, it's just like we just talked to each other yesterday. So, yeah.
Yeah, man. It's like no time has passed. No time has
Yes,
passed. But
yes, indeed.
you have all my contact info, right?
I think so. If not, I'll get it. And I'll make sure, you know, we'll exchange numbers and everything like that. And listen, anytime you need to holler, scream at me, call, you just want to talk, I don't care what it is. We're good. Believe
Heck
me when
yeah.
I say we're good, bro.
Heck yeah, brother. Thank you so much. It's been an honor and a privilege, for sure.
Indeed. So now I got to ask you the last question I always ask everybody is, what was the last song you listened to?
Last song I listened to. Let me think. What's the last thing that I played? Probably it had to be like Polyphia's Champagne.
Right.
I had to think because I have, you know, I've been, I work and like, so when I'm in work mode, a lot of times I just come home and crash and I'm just whatever. And then last night we had bowling league, so I was trying to think last time I actually threw music on
right.
in the background. It would have to be Polyphia's Champagne.
Well, see, I always like to ask people that question because we as creatives and musicians, there's no telling what we're listening to because we love music. So that's why I always like to answer that question.
I love all of it, man. I love all of it. Like, I even love, like, the super pop mix that they'll play at the bowling alley.
Because,
like, you can see, they play all, like, top 40 stuff, but then they play the videos behind it during like cosmic bowling and stuff, and
right.
I find that interesting because I'll watch the videos and start picking the videos apart like production wise,
right?
And then try to like backwards engineer of like why did they do this or
right?
How did they shoot that or what was the possible inspiration behind like how do you get from point A to, and then end up at point C? You know what I mean?
You're creative, bro. That makes sense. Indeed, because I feel you, because I'm not a genre snob. I love all music, man, and that's just how I grew up, man. So that's a beautiful thing, bro. It really
I love it, man. I'm really into there's a country band called Lanco. And I've been getting into them. They're kind of newer, but their guitarist, Tim Avon, has a YouTube channel. And he's teaching people all about the Nashville guitar scene and what it's like to be a touring, gigging, studio musician in Nashville. So I'm super like enamored with that right now.
Yeah, because Nashville is big, man. I have some friends who actually moved to Nashville for music. You know, Chase Rice is the one band that my brother Jeremy plays for. He's the drummer for them. And Jeremy is beyond. Jeremy is amazing. But he plays with Chase Rice. So he moved to Nashville. So there's a lot of people up there, man. Indeed.
I just love it. I love it. And like the last big interview I watched is I think I watched like almost a 2-hour interview with Brad Paisley. Mm-hmm. And he kind of runs through like his whole career. And it was all guitar based because it was a guitar based podcast. And he was talking about how he got these particular amps, these Vox AC30s, and he went from Mesas to the Vox amps and then found his sound and then got the band and cut the record. And and got the deal, and then not knowing if he would get a second deal,
right?
And pushing, picking what songs were gonna go and become singles and big hits and kind of all that, but looking at that whole kind of outlook from a mainstream country artist.
Mm-hmm.
And seeing that they go through the same kind of,
course,
like timeline
that
we all go through. Super interesting.
Hey, music is music. Now it's not going to be better than this conversation right here now, but it was.
No, it was good though, man. It was super inspiring, and like I don't understand people that are like super genre specific, and they're like, I only like this. But does that mean you go home and you eat the same bowl of cereal every night? You drink it from the same cup every night?
I agree. 100%. We're kissing like, spirits on that, bro.
Like, you, sir, are stale.
Yes, indeed. Well, listen, the last thing is the floor is yours. If you have anything to say, please say it. And also let people know where they can get in touch with you guys and see you guys.
Okay. So the mentalhallexperiment.com is the main hub for everything. The Mental Health Experiment, you'll get our social media links there. You can get all of our merchandise there. You can get all the tour up and news updates and everything that's happening for us current day there. And just a huge thank you for having me on. And I can't wait to do this again, man.
Yes, indeed. Well, look, bro, you made my day. You made my week, man. Listen, I got another one later on this week, but I'm telling you, this has been great. It's been a great conversation, and I appreciate you 100%, my brother.
And see, I knew it was going to happen like this.
Yes.
That's why I told Sean last week. I said, just ask him to move it, because
right,
if it's going to be a short conversation, I want to give 100% to it.
Yeah,
just ask him to move it.
Yeah, no doubt. I usually don't have too short of conversations.
Yeah, me neither.
Yeah.
People usually have to tell me, shut up.
No, man, I enjoy it because I want to know who you are. I want to know about you. And I, you know, legitimately, authentically, I want to know who you are and what you do. And that's how, you know, I treat every single guest. And that's just who I am. And so once again, I appreciate you, bro. It's been an amazing conversation. So, ladies and gentlemen, once again, you know who it is. It is the big guy with the big show, the Lord. Got a pause always right there. Nelson, that is. Yes, indeed. From the podcast Live and Loud with the Lord on the CMS Network with Five Royals Entertainment with this amazing individual again, with this amazing individual again, with this amazing human being. With this amazing human being, I gotta say it again. Brandy Mend It All from the Mend It All Experiment. Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed, bro. I appreciate you so much, bro.
Thank you.
Yes, indeed.
your life. This is your life.
Ha 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 ha!